Hello and welcome to the only state to log 8% GDP growth even during the COVID-19 pandemic period. The SaaS capital of India, Tamil Nadu received the highest amount of fresh industrial investments and is the front runner in post-COVID investments in the country. It has shown how states can adapt and rebuild economies in the new normal. Home to global capability centers and financial hubs, it boasts of an excellent industrial ecosystem, trained manpower, connectivity, connected supply chains, pragmatic policies, and proactive leaders. Most recently, the Honorable Deputy Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, Thiru O. Paneerselvam, during his official visit to the United States of America, had invited investors to fund projects in Tamil Nadu. Our session, Tamil Nadu Land of Opportunities, aims to discuss the various factors that contribute to the growth of Tamil Nadu's real estate sector and highlight the potential in residential, commercial and industrial segments. On behalf of the people of Tamil Nadu, I would like to take this opportunity to thank our leadership. The Honorable Chief Minister, Thiru Edappadi K. Palaniswamy, and the Honorable Deputy Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, Thiru O. Paneerselvam, and the Government of Tamil Nadu for the remarkable efforts in keeping us safe during Cyclone Nivar. This session will be chaired by a real estate pioneer. Mr. Jerry Kingsley has an exceptional understanding of the Chennai real estate market. He has managed several complex projects with consummate ease. He has been involved in different facets of the real estate consultancy business, from developer representation to incentive negotiations to assignments in Coimbatore, Kochi, Salem and Madurai. He also shoulders additional responsibility in driving the warehousing and logistics solutions business of Johns Lang LaSalle on pan-India basis.
On behalf of the UEF World Summit, I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome every delegate who has joined here for these 3 days. The United Economic Forum was founded in the year 1979 by Dr. B.S. Abdul Rahman. True to its vision, the forum acts as a premier chamber of commerce, bringing together businessmen, industrialists, professional technocrats, entrepreneurs, and NGOs to collectively work for the betterment of the society. One of the primary goals of the forum is to provide necessary support and support and enablement to the entrepreneurs and the businesses to facilitate investments for the state of Tamil Nadu and for investments at large. For the next 60 minutes, we have a panel discussion, and each panelist is a pioneer, a beacon, and a visionary in real estate. The topic of discussion is Tamil Nadu, land of investment opportunities. Before we start the panel discussion, I will go around and have a quick round of introduction, and then we will start the panel discussion. First of all, we have Thiru Rajesh Lakoni. Thiru Rajesh Lakoni is the current Principal Secretary to the Government, Housing and Urban Development Department, and IAS Officer of Batch 1992, who has formerly held the post of Principal Secretary CMDA, and also the collector of Theni, and has also held various prestigious posts. Sir, we are very happy to have you with us, and many thanks for your time. Next, we have Arun Kumar, founder and managing director of Casagrant. He has been instrumental in steering the company as one of the largest real estate developer in the country. Under his leadership, the company has expanded its operation to several cities. Casagrant currently has developed over 60 projects with a built-up space of 9 million square feet across Chennai, Bangalore and Coimbatore, and has another 30 projects with a total built area of 9 million square feet. Arun, many thanks again for your time, and we really value your inputs for this session. We also have Ajit Chodia, who is the promoter and managing director of the Olympia Group. Olympia Group has built space of 8 million square feet across commercial, residential, several alternate asset classes like warehousing, co-living, educational and retail. Ajit's family business, the Kivraj Group, has been in existence for over 5 decades. Kivraj Group's key businesses includes automobile dealership, retail, wind and renewable energy, to name a few. Many thanks, Ajit, for joining us again. We look forward to your inputs. We also have Sridhar. Sridhar manages the Newry Group, earlier called Sonex Realty Private Limited, with over 75 projects spanning 2.5 million square feet of residential and commercial space. Trustee of Makija Foundation and URI Group also runs two schools under the banner Srishti Schools. Sridhar is closely associated with Art of Living, takes philanthropy very seriously. And Sridhar also currently holds the post of chairman of CREDAI Tamil Nadu. Finally, we have Habib, W.S. Habib, chairman and managing director of RWD. He's the first generation entrepreneur. In 2006, Habib formed RWD along with Ramki, a group of Hyderabad. And their total experience would include 30 million square feet of project and another 30 million square feet under development. Habib is the immediate past president of CREDAI Chennai and is the director general of United Economic Forum. And currently, he is the chairman of this World Summit. Many thanks, gentlemen, for making time for this evening. And we have a very interesting session lined up. So just to set the context, we're going to talk about Tamil Nadu. We're going to talk about the various investment opportunities here. So before we start off, we're going to have a brief presentation about the key investment focus, you know, investment points for the state. And then we will, you know, jump into the panel discussion. So that I'm putting up the presentation now. So over the next couple of minutes, I'll just quickly run through key important investment facts for the state. Tamil Nadu has always been a powerhouse of investments in India. It's ranked first in several factors, highest number of factories, highest number of skilled manpower, highest number of SEZs. The good thing about our state is it's not dependent on one specific segment, one specific sector. There are different sectors which are you know, driving the economy here. You've got manufacturing, you've got IT, you've got auto, electronics. Having a port presence also kind of helps the import-export activity. Consistently, Tamil Nadu has been attracting a huge amount of foreign direct investment. It's been rated by several agencies as one of the top destination for investors to choose. So briefly, you know, if you look at the different segments, if you look at the commercial real estate market, Tamil Nadu has always scored very high, Chennai and the other cities. Currently, Chennai has an overall stock of about 80 million square feet of space. And this year also, we've seen good amount of investments happening, close to 4.5 million square feet, which has got transacted just in the first three quarters. And if you look at the investments happening, you've got DLF promoting a large project, you've got L&T, Tidal Power, Capital Land, Olympia, all of them developing, you know, large projects, IT projects here. And the good thing is, it's not only about one specific city. You have activity happening in Coimbatore, where Elcott is developing large IT parks. Wipro, TCS, HCL are all tenants. You've got Trichy, where Sutherland, HCL, WNS are tenants. You've got Madurai, Salem. So a lot of activity happening, not only in the primary state of Chennai, but also in other smaller cities. Moving on to residential, if you look at residential as a segment, this year in the third quarter, if you look at the third quarter stats, we've got launches which has exceeded the previous quarter by about 700%. You've got sales which has exceeded 240%. And what we are seeing is home buyers are making serious investment because of various factors, you know, of interest rate being low, the pent-up demand being high. Investments also happening in tier two, tier three cities, a lot of focus on technology. We'll speak less about this because we've got experts who will be speaking more about residential. Also, if you look at the industrial and the warehousing space, Chennai, Tamil Nadu has been a very mature industrial state, attracting investments right from 1990s, right, when Ford, BMW, all these companies invested. And that trend continues to remain, you know, mainly because of port-based activity, skilled manpower, government initiatives like SIPCOT, and the various incentives which are given by the government. It's not only about these traditional sectors, there are emerging sectors like a data center, for instance, which has seen very, very high interest this specific year. Chennai currently has a demand for 32 megawatt. Many companies have invested, Netmagic, Yota, Adani, Colt. The main reason being the submarine landing cables are in Tamil Nadu and Chennai, which is kind of attracting investments in data center. There are new emerging sectors as well, co-living and student housing, which we will hear from the panelists today. Healthcare, a lot of healthcare investments happening considering the situation which we are going through. Life sciences, biotechnology, aerospace, and defense. Finally, I just like to summarize by saying there are different sectors. Every sector has attracted large investments. If you look at commercial, you've got Brookfield, GIC, Mapletree, Apollo, Xander. If you look at industrial, Indospace, ESR, all these institutional players have invested. Many of the residential debt players are also very active data center players. So Tamil Nadu as a destination has always been very lucrative, which is what we're going to discuss more in detail as we move forward in this. So, gentlemen, to start off with, Habib, the first question is to you. I mean, we saw about a lot of stats about Tamil Nadu being an investment destination. You've been in business for a long time. What do you think are the key USPs for Tamil Nadu to attract investments?
Thank you, Jerry. I think your presentation really covered up some at all, but whatever you missed out, maybe I think I will highlight here. We are the second largest economy. In fact, I would say we are first. You know, there was a report last month for someone, you know, which says that, you know, most of the factories here are headquartered in Maharashtra. So if you take that account, we are number one. But okay, let's say we are number two in the economy. First in many areas where, you know, we have a lot of factories here, a lot of employees. We are first in a lot of employees employed in these factories. We are third in the gross industrial output. We are the economic development index. We are second. First in many, you know, we have 40 operational and exporting SEZs. Then engineering students out from the colleges, you know, Tamil Nadu stands at number one. We are a power surplus state. In fact, the renewable energy, we are number one. There are more tourists arrival to this part of the world. Of course, the COVID is stopped now. We are the largest in the leather, and one third of the India's automobile being produced here in Tamil Nadu. We are the third largest in the software exports, second best in the infra, number one in law and order. You know, that's very important, you know, peace and tranquility. Our environment is good. We have the pollution levels are definitely far superior than other states. The justice system is really good. 61 out of the 500 Fortune companies are set up in Tamil Nadu. And government is very proactive, and a lot of incentive packages, tax holiday has been given by the government of Tamil Nadu. In fact, a single window approval has been given for 30 days. So there are plenty. I mean, we have a long coastline and so many things. I think we are really fortunate to be in Tamil Nadu is what I would say when it comes to those states.
Thanks, Habib. Those are all very, very valid and, you know, very well-taken inputs. Next, Thiru Rajesh Lakoni, sir. Government has been very proactive in bringing several policy-level initiatives to promote the state, promote real estate and housing in particular. We would be very, very keen to hear your views on the government policy's roles to build and sustain this growth. If we can hear from you, please.
To start, before going to the real estate policy, I think the Tamil Nadu, the development model has been a mixed development model. This is a place where if you see high-rise building will be there and there will be a small slum nearby. Perhaps it's the only city where the slums are there and we have developed the slum tenements in the beachfront itself. The whole idea is that the community should be mixed so that the need for travel and the city should be less. And city should be able to cater to all the requirements of all kinds of people. That's why housing has been very important sector and real estate has been very important sector. It has been growing really nicely, and especially the residential and commercial also. Now IT has really picked up, and it was really very steadily growing for last few times. And I think now it is there's a time for it to jump. After some time. But our always focus has been basically to remove what are the difficulties for doing ease of doing business in Tamil Nadu and even for real estate factor. For example, one major important thing for us is basically how do we simplify the approval process. This simplification is a major broad area in the sense that first removing all the difficulties, then making the statute and rules simple so that it is understandable both by the developer as well as by the regulator. Regulator in the sense that the person who is issuing the planning permission. So those reforms have been done. Earlier, there was major changes in the sense the rules were changing every 50 or 60 kilometers at building application rules. Now, throughout the state, there's a common rule. And even approval process has been simplified. A lot of things have been automated. What now we have started is a basically dialogue, continuous dialogue with CREDAI and other agencies to remove their difficulty on a continuous basis instead of doing one kind of reform and taking it up. And not only we are dealing with CREDAI, there are small developers whom also we are continuously engaging and finding out what are their issues and difficulties. So that is being done on a continuous basis. I think we have really simplified the rules, and I think getting approvals is getting simpler and simpler, and it will definitely improve much better. That is one thing. The second, another thing which I like to really mention here, apart from the RERA and all, which are national amendment and that has been brought up, is we are basically in India offer almost very high FSI. Maybe one or two states are equivalent in offering the floor space index of the kind which we are offering, which basically translates that the cost of unit comes down because the land cost basically come down proportionately because of this FSI thing, which is another area, I think, in which Tamil Nadu has taken a leap, and we want to develop small cohesive cities so that people's everything is scattered, needs are scattered into a small area. And all the facilities or infrastructure facilities are provided quicker and in servicing everyone instead of widely spreading it over a large area.
Got it, sir. Got it. So I think all these are, very, very welcome moves by the government. And we definitely feel this will go a long way to further increase the attractiveness, of our state. Also, moving on, residential real estate actually forms probably about 80-85% of real estate in India. And Arun, all our delegates would be keen to hear from you on how the residential market is currently behaving. What are the trends which we are seeing as the largest residential developer? We'll be keen to hear this from you, Arun, broad trends in residential real estate.
Thank you so much, Jerry. And to the forum, by and large, when the whole lockdown happened, the whole country and so was our state, looming with a question as to how this market is going to play out, how would, home buyers behave. More so because we expected a lot more of job opportunity losses and a lot of pay cuts and increment cuts and so on and so forth. Though I really have not done enough research to assimilate the stats on what's really happened in the employment front. Though there are speculative information flowing through regarding job cuts and so on and so forth, what I have by and large seen in the last 4 months, when we really, what we did as an organization is we started slamming the accelerator after the lockdown happened to see how the home buyers would behave. So we went about five launches and huge launches, and we accelerated the whole sales with a little attractive pricing and offers and so on and so forth. What we are surprised is I would believe we are already back to where we would have been if not for the lockdown to have happened in the same month. We did close to about 350 crores every month, which is pretty shocking in our own sense. We did close to about 1,400-1,500 crores of sales in the last 3-4 months. It's played out pretty well. Home buyers seem to be coming. They don't seem to really be getting too bogged down by the whole lockdown. If job losses and in the bonuses cuts are a big reason, then this would not have happened. However, we're seeing a sizable traction predominantly in the price band of 45 lakhs to 75 lakhs. And above that, there's a marginal resistance. And below that, obviously, we are not operating, so we wouldn't know that. So this is how it is playing. I think every month has been growing consistently. I think with good products and good pricing, home buyers are willing to buy. Maybe for few reasons that actually after this whole lockdown, they've understood the value of home. The second thing which possibly has happened is seeing the other investment opportunities like stock market and other things taking a sizable beating and not able to handle the kind of a pressure of seeing the value erode. I think they are all realizing that real estate buying seems to make sense, and they're feeling more connected home, being locked down for 4 months. So all these things put together, I think real estate residential in Chennai has done extremely well for us and for the whole market per se. I've heard a lot of other builders also say that it's been very good. Maybe it's also because of the little bit of pent-up demand, which could have happened in the 4 months when the home buying was more or less stalled. But with all these things, I think we're seeing a very comfortable regain of the market. And by Jan, I think the whole market should feel normal.
Wonderful, Arun. Wonderful. Very good to know. We always consider Casagrande as the barometer of residential in Chennai. And if you feel that, you know, the residential sales has picked up, it's a very, very positive sentiment for the market at large. Moving on to the next sector. Ajit, I mean, you are the largest commercial developer, you know, in this part of the country, with I think over 2.5 million square feet of space already constructed and several million square feet proposed. So, what are the broad trends, Ajit, are you seeing from the commercial market per se? What are the trends? The work from home, all these new things which we are hearing. What is it that you are seeing? What is happening in the parks which you are currently running?
See, on the one hand, it is very little premature today to really say how the markets are going to span in the days to come, because most of the large IT companies which are there are still working from home. You look at my building, which is there, which has about 15,000 people working, but we have hardly 700 or 800 people coming every day. So the business is yet to start. So earlier they said January. So now it looks, now the vaccine, if only if it is going to come to Chennai. So we are now looking only by March, April is what the occupancy of the existing buildings is going to start. Coming to the trends, people have started moving one step ahead of the Griha rating or the green building rating. And people have, the developers have started adopting the WELS certification. So the wellness is being given much, much, much more weightage today by the developers. This trend started even before this pandemic, but the pandemic has only accelerated the adoption of the technology which is there for wellness. So the existing buildings which were there, where we were looking at retrofitment to beat the or to overcome some of the issues with the pandemic, but those particular things are still, it is wait and watch. On a large scale, we have not seen, we were contemplating or other developers were contemplating going in for HEPA filters, which are there for their existing air conditioning system, but they're not practical. A lot of other technologies seem to have come, which we are sure will help us to mitigate the problem which are there on account of the pandemic. The occupancy norms, we expected that the occupancy norms will undergo a change. And with about 20-25% of the people will be working from home long term. And the space occupancy, which is there per person, which used to be 100, will probably go to 125 or 80 to 100, 100 to 125 or 125 to 150 square feet per person. But that trend is yet to be seen. We are not seeing that particular trend. Coming to vacancies, yes, a small amount of vacancies have started coming in. But the good part is good portion of the vacancy is getting absorbed. So newer clients are also coming in. People are, we have been able to sign at least about 50-60,000 square feet of space in the last 2 months. And sales also have been fairly good, even in the commercial. The demand has been very, very good. The investors with the interest rates plummeting to below 6%, the commercial real estate offers some excellent returns today. So we are seeing huge investor demand in retail investors or HNI investors demand in the office building segment. And coming to the new projects which are there, yeah, 1 year we will be probably be having a lull, but then almost all companies which we are talking to, they are telling that their plans are firm, they are here to grow, and they will be coming back. It's just waiting for the right time. So I think post, at least once the US stabilizes with the elections over, we should be seeing good amount of business coming to India and to Chennai.
Wonderful, Ajit. Good to hear, because we always feel commercial doing well will always have a spin-off benefits to several other sectors. And we also firmly believe that irrespective of whatever has happened in 2020, commercial real estate is definitely going through a very, very strong segment. And we will see green shoots of it in the coming year, which is 2021. Moving on, Sridhar, as the chairman of CREDAI Tamil Nadu, you'll have a macro view of not only Chennai, but what's happening in the other cities. So what are your colleagues telling in the other cities in Tamil Nadu, especially on the affordable housing segment?
Hi, good evening, Jari. Yeah, thanks for giving this opportunity. See, whatever impact, like what Arun had spoken about, the demand in Chennai and suburbs of Chennai has phenomenally gone up. of whatever we thought in the lockdown. We thought the lockdown is really is going to be a setback. It was a setback, but what we came back is also a very strong comeback we have done. It is the same sentiments from all the other small towns also. If you take even a place like Salem, Viluppuram, all the smaller towns, B, C cities also have got a very good demand. I think the overall impact of this is people have started feeling the importance of a house. This pandemic has taught them a very big lesson that house is very important. That has got into their mind. Plus, what we have been repeatedly saying, a lot of NRIs have started buying. The people who have been working here, working from home, they've also started showing a lot of keen interest. And it is spread across. And coming to affordable housing, I think, you know, the boost in affordable housing, thanks to the CBR amendment and thanks to our principal secretary. See, we changed the rule as 60 square meter for Chennai city and Chennai corporation limit and 90 square meter outside the corporation limit. This has given a very big relief. This 90 square meter, even if you're going to do in the suburbs of Chennai, up to 90 square meters, up to 45 lakhs is considered as affordable housing, which is not only gets you an income tax benefit, it also gives you a 1% GST. This is added as a very big boost, and almost all the towns and centers, I can say Madurai, Trichy, Coimbatore, all of them have started affordable housing, and it is a welcome relief. The only relief which we are expecting from the central government is the limit of 45 lakhs to be increased to 75 lakhs. This is a long pending demand from our side. I think if that 75 lakhs comes, I think the affordable housing sector in all the throughout Tamil Nadu, it will do well, and suburbs of Chennai also will do very well.
Wonderful, wonderful, Sridhar. Good to hear that a lot of activity happening, not only in the primary city, but cities outside Tamil Nadu as well. Moving on, Habib, you've been a big supporter, you know, supporter of tier 2, tier 3 cities, right? So in all your investments and, you know, your view. So, you know, my question is tier 2, tier 3 cities are gaining prominence with investors. So what do you think are the opportunities for somebody looking at investments beyond Chennai?
Yeah, so you're right. So tier 1 cities like Chennai is like, you know, bursting in seams and with a lot of traffic, pollution, the quality of life is getting bad. So I think there's no other option other than tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 towns, you know, in Tamil Nadu. The primary reason why it is all growing is because, you know, I mean, you'd be surprised that Tamil Nadu is the only state, you know, have all all the districts in Tamil Nadu covered under the industrial corridor projects. You know, be it Chennai, Bangalore industrial corridor or defense industrial corridor projects. There's Chennai, Kanyakumari industrial projects, you know, Kochi, Coimbatore, Madurai, Thoothukudi corridor is all, you know, These are things which is really, driving Tamil Nadu. And, we have excellent, connectivity in terms of highways and railway networks. We have 6 airports, you know, out of which 4 are international. We have a long coastline, 3 major ports and 15 minor ports. So, and the government of Tamil Nadu has, you know, also attracted, you know, they have permitted the state-owned SIPCOT to develop new industrial projects in joint venture with private landowners, you know, owning 100 acres or more. So these things are really like, you know, taking the, making it more attractive. Tamil Nadu is getting more attractive by all these things. So now when you talk about the, what are the opportunities there, the organized community living, like, you know, we have some great projects in Chennai. If you see a lot of community living, you know, all the developers here in this forum creating wonderful spaces. So these things, you know, even the districts people want it. So the residential is going to be really booming. As of now, it's doing well, but, you know, more organized residential developments is possible. In fact, we also doing not many projects in the south in Tirunelveli. Even the smaller towns, it's actually doing good. The retail, you know, the organized retail is like going to be really a big hit, you know. I was surprised, you know, the large retail brands in India are entering to smaller towns of Tamil Nadu. I come from a small place called Kailpattanam, where the population is 3,000. I see a small, opportunity to do a small mall there. You know, I was actually hesitant. But then when I started this, you know, I realized, a lot of bigger brands want to come for a smaller town. So that really encourages me. So, you know, we try to do more of those. And of course, your industrial and other warehouses, you know, the big opportunity there. Healthcare infrastructure, Tamil Nadu always prefers healthcare destination. the medical tourism, we have a lot of opportunities here. So I'm very gung-ho about this entire Tamil Nadu, entire tier 2, tier 3 things, which is definitely going to go good. And just that, a little more infrastructure is required, more grid roads is required, and a few more airports. I think, we are well set for a good future.
Dr. Habib, very good to know that beyond residential, definitely there is scope for, organized retail in a small format manner, as you said, in the smaller towns and districts available in Tamil Nadu. Thiru Rajesh Lakoni, sir, the next question is that owning a home has always been an Indian dream, for anybody, any person in India. So what are the possibilities of achieving this dream in today's housing market, and what role do you think the government can play in this, sir?
This is a relevant question because of, I think, the present pandemic situation. And I think the importance of home has already been highlighted by, and I think it's been exacerbated by this new pandemic, and people are now going towards buying home. Now, the government, actually, I mentioned that why we increased the FSI. I think most of the home in basically core urban areas are unaffordable because the lands are very priced very heavily. And because the construction cost is almost flat across various areas, whether urban and rural, maybe the difference is not that much. But the difference is mainly on the land cost. Now, so the cost of the flat or a home becomes very high. So basically, government really intervened a few years, I think 1.5 or 2 years before. And what we said is that the only way we can reduce the price of an apartment is by increasing the FSI. And compared to many countries, I think we have really, we compare the data and we have really increased the FSI significantly. And that, I think, and we have provided a lot of premium FSI and the rates also have been rationalized. I think that will basically reduce the price of an home in basically core or metropolitan area and surrounding area. That is one major significant initiative has been taken. And it is, one is, this is a direct benefit. The second benefit is that in the sense near, what we have done is near the metro rail corridors, we have increased the FSI further in the sense that we have given discount of 50% and premium FSI. So FSI is even further. So we want to densify the city along the metro rail corridors so that people can travel fast and they don't use the personalized vehicle and they can use the metro rail. So their time is saved. And this way they can slightly travel slightly far and thus can afford a home instead of coming directly to the core city. So these benefits are really making the home houses affordable. And definitely over a period of time, for the new projects, the cost will come down and affordability will increase and people will definitely come forward to buy. The second thing I'd like to emphasize is that basically affordable housing. In the sense earlier, the affordable housing definition was very stringent. We have brought it very wide in the sense that up to 90 square meter beyond Chennai city can be called as an affordable housing. Now the builders have two benefits. First is, they get some income tax relief, and it, because of the affordable housing, so they get slightly more FSI and basically faster approvals. So that way the cost, time cost of things come down, and I think the total overall charges which they have to pay to government for approval in terms of fees and etc. also comes down. So this also really brings down the cost of flat in core city as well as periphery, and these two will really make things, houses affordable for the people living in Chennai. Thank you.
Noted, sir. Noted, sir. Very valid inputs. Bringing down the FSI cost of land, giving the premium FSI along the metro corridors, and also focus on affordable housing is definitely something which will go a long way, because all the developers here have been doing a lot of value engineering to bring the overall cost of construction down, which will anyway overall help the affordability for the home buyer. Arun, the next question, is to you. Arun, even in any market, Casagrande has been known to raise capital, right? Whether when the market was good, when you have so many NBFCs, or even in today's market, financial institution are backing a developer like you, and you kind of interact with all these institutions on a daily basis. So if you can just shed some light on the other view, what are the financial institutions' view on the residential real estate segment and also broadly on Chennai?
See, the financial institutions have actually, obviously been pretty slow in terms of how they have been seeing the market, in terms of the residential market across the country. They have taken a, back foot in terms of what has transpired post the IL&FS crisis and so on and so forth. Not so much of a lockdown an issue, but, post that. And with a lot of moratoriums being offered in terms of timelines, they have taken a backseat because they need to show the earnings every month. So they have gone a little slow for sure. They are doing a wait and watch mode. But everybody is continuously engaging with us in terms of, future investment opportunities. But I see that they are very upbeat with the developers who are being realistic about the expectations of the project's success and hence willing to take a call on the pricing and offer it and see continuous, churn or liquidity. They are very happy with the developers who are able to create consistent levels of liquidity by selling up the apartments, etc. As against a few developers who might have taken a call to be a little more, sticky to the price which they have projected. So that's exactly what I'm seeing. So if they understand that if we need to take a haircut at a point in time in terms of margin expectations, you need to take that and move on. So if they see that, I think they are okay with that. They need to see the cash bell ringing. The other thing is obviously they want to see a consistent intent of the developer to continuously progress on the project in terms of sale, construction, collection, construction further and so on and so forth. So if they see that there is no much of a difficulty, they do seem to have interest. Obviously, let's be realistic here that they have taken a back foot in terms of a land funding stage of funding. But post-approval projects getting funding is not difficult at all at the moment, as long as you're showing reasonable amount of traction in terms of sales. And that's not for Casa Grant per se. I would think a lot of the good developers here in this forum or otherwise can mobilize the money. I don't see. And they understand that Chennai builders are a lot more realistic, a lot more careful, are very wary and very cautious themselves. That actually, they have a good opinion about Chennai market per se, and they are willing to have their, eyes wide and wide open for opportunities here.
Wonderful, Arun. Good to know that, investors are looking at developer credentials. And as you rightly said, the customer is what even the financial institution is looking at, whether the developer is able to, do whatever required to ensure that sales happen, construction happen. Once that is done, the financial institution also view things differently. Moving on, Ajit, on a similar view, you've been interacting with, a lot of these private equity players. You've been successful in forging partnerships on the commercial space in many of your commercial projects. So what are the financial institution PE funds view on commercial? Because this year, this year has been the year where biggest commercial real estate deals have happened, whether Brookfield investing or Blackstone investing. So what are the views from the investors from a commercial perspective, Ajit?
I think the investors are very gung-ho with Chennai, and a good amount of money is available for investment in Chennai in the commercial. It is not only the commercial which is there, but even other than retail, there is a pause at this point of time. But other than retail, whether it is industrial or commercial, there's a huge demand which is there. In fact, I have discussions with at least three or four private equity investors who are keen for having a platform level investment for industrial itself they would like to forge. So it is not like one side. They say, look at least about 300 acres in and around Chennai, so by which we are able to promote at least three industrial parks in different corridors of Chennai. So that is the level. The production-linked incentive scheme, which was rolled by the government first for the electronic and then followed by automotive, which was announced just a couple of weeks back, and Make in India. These two things have been a big, big game changer for Chennai, because we had one of the best infrastructure for industrial. So you look at Oragadam, you look at Sriperumbatore. I don't think there'll be too many parallels in the country as far as the industrial estates are concerned. City for IT, yes, what we lack is probably one more Elcott, Scholing and Ennore probably is required so that the government is able to make available developed land if it can be made available like what has been given in Scholing and Ennore, because that is full. Sirsiri is still little away, but somewhere else if the government were to look at to come with an estate, I think we would see good amount of interest coming. So today only there are two corridors, the OMR, the Guindy, and then you have the Pallavaram Thuraipakkam. And Ambattur will again develop thanks to the initiative of the government. The tidal park which is coming in that Pattabhiraman, I'm sure that is again going to be a game changer for that particular area. So there is a good demand for offices. Investors are there waiting. Even today they are willing to place their bets on the IT and industry.
All right, Ajit. So, you know, key is developing these IT parks in the right location will always be backed by, you know, enough and more private equity and institutional players who are willing to back developers is the key message. And capital available and commercial is definitely not scarce. Moving on, Sridhar, you're an active representative of the Builder Forum as the chairman of Kretai Tamil Nadu. So if you can just give some views on the policies which the forum, you know, which the bodies are driving to you know, sustain growth in this sector.
Yeah, we have been consistently following up with the government. You know, after this pandemic, in fact, after the CBR came in, we were very, very happy so that, you know, the market started moving up. But this pandemic really did bring us back by a step. But subsequent to that, we have been, you know, we expect the government to come out with some sort of an incentive to the industry so that we come back with full force. The main demand has been to, you know, to reduce the stamp duty. The stamp duty, which we are paying now, which is almost 11%, is the highest in the country. So we have been demanding. We have been having continuous dialogue with the government. We are in an advanced stage. Hope we get some relief. A solid example is government of Maharashtra. Maharashtra government brought down the stamp duty. You know, the sales there has almost picked up by 60 to 70% pre-COVID. What was pre-COVID 100 has become 160 to 170 today. So this is the type of, you know, the amount of hype that the government has got, and a lot of investors are expecting that the stamp duty reduction is going to be a very big relief. And the same thing on the stamp duty, recently the central government, you know, there was a recommendation to all the states to scrap the stamp duty for affordable housing. If at all that is implemented, that will be a very big boost to the government, you know, to the industry. These are some of the demands that we are aggressively following up with the government. Next is on the charges. You know, there has been over a period of time, all the charges that are being paid, you know, either it is in the CMDA, DTCP or in the local body, have all gone up substantially. So we have made a request for them to bring down all the charges and the security deposit and all, you know, after the implementation of RERA and the completion certificate, the security deposit becomes, it is not a needed one. These are all things which we have done before. So we have made a representation to take away the security deposit. This comes in because it improves the liquidity of the builder so that the cost comes down. Ultimately, the customer benefits. So to bring down, you know, now the interest cost is what is killing the builder right from the beginning. You know, all these payments can be paid upfront at the time of getting the planning permission. So these are the aggressive demands that we have been making to the government. And the final and the single most demand is the single window system. I think if the single window system is brought in, that is going to be a very big relief, which will give a very big boost to the real estate demand in the state. We'll find large players from other states also coming into Tamil Nadu. They're all waiting. I think if these steps are going to be implemented, there will be a lot of positive steps. I think, you know, we are in talks with the government. They are very, very favorable towards it. We expect some good decisions soon.
Wonderful, Sridhar. Kretai body has always been very active in bringing in best practices from the other states as well. So we are very, very sure that, you know, these will be implemented here. Arun, Ajit briefly touched upon it. Interest in warehousing. You know, you've made a very, very successful exit to a large Australian fund. You're doing another one as we speak. What are your views on warehousing opportunities, which you know, builders can look at, you know, in the years to come?
Industrial warehousing has really caught on pretty strong in the Chennai market, and there's been sizable interest in terms of developments. And actually, we have, in fact, we've had interest from quite a few of the fund houses to even start a new bigger platform of close to 500 to 1000 crores. And what's happened is the exit which we did with you know, Logos, which is Australian warehousing company, of the first park which we did was about 80 acres, actually is also given a lot of very good clients, you know, good spaces. See, what used to happen prior to this, you know, was the fact that actually a lot of independent landowners used to build sheds and used to give it on rents. But, you know, those were not parks with a lot of, you know, common facilities, etc. So when clients today see parks being developed with a lot of good common facilities, office spaces, maybe, you know, hostels for, you know, members who work and so on and so forth, which is comes comprehensive, there seems to be a sizable traction. But obviously, as I see that, you know, when there was a huge demand, the rental went up to as high as about 28, 29 bucks, 29 rupees, which is huge for an industrial space. So what's happening is those corrections are happening now. Because actually a good warehousing and a industrial park is viable only from a location which is upwards of 70 lakhs to downwards of over 1.4, 1.5 crores per acre. Anything beyond that gets out of reach. So, but 27 rupees extra is too steep a yield, and then hence it becomes unviable for that tenant. So the pricing is now taking a marginal beating, but given that if you are able to, you know, acquire the lands efficiently and able to do the construction about 1,400 rupees per square foot kind of a number, I think at anywhere rental of about 18 to 24 rupees, etc. is comfortably viable. At that model, there's huge amounts of traction because the REITs are coming in. You know, who knows, we can build a platform and REIT it ourselves. It's a great business potential. And obviously, a Chennai market, when they already the investment environment has been good. But if the government obviously supports it with a lot of, you know, subsidies, whatsoever, etc., for the industries who set up shop, there'll be huge traction. And I see Chennai market doing extremely well. It's already always done well. You all know that. And I can do even better. In fact, we are getting very, very big clients now. In fact, in the next 1 to 2 months, we will release the news out. We are working with a very big client. The whole government and the guidance bureau has been working very closely with us. It is really surprising the way government has been so proactive towards investments. So a lot of such good things are happening. I'm very excited about what's ahead in terms of industrial warehousing.
Wonderful, Arun. I mean, globally, what we are seeing again is while other sectors are going through, you know, this period of uncertainty, warehousing and logistics has kind of stood apart, you know, has stood apart because of e-commerce, because of various other online aspects, you know, domestic manufacturing and things like that. And as you rightly pointed out, the success is land. You want to say anything, Arun?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that it's not warehousing. I would want to call that industrial and warehousing because in Chennai, industrial plays a very big role, I mean, component to the whole park. You know, if it's only a pure play warehousing park, we might really not get the kind of attraction which we might want. Whereas industrial, consider the fact that there's so much of automobile manufacturing units, their components, etc. There's huge traction there. So it's industrial and warehousing is how I would want to, you know,
readable factories, warehousing, both put together, auto, electronic manufacturing has always had huge demand in Chennai, which will continue to do so. Ajit, just moving on as an alternate investment opportunity, you have kind of pioneered in the rental market with your tie-ups with co-living players, student housing, and you've also now been exploring data centers. What are the opportunities available outside office, residential, as well as manufacturing and warehousing?
I think if someone is looking at a portfolio of rental assets, then they cannot be just heavy on the office buildings which are there. So there need to be a mix of other non-traditional the rental assets which are there. The new assets which have emerged is the co-living, as well as the schools. So we, for us, it was a compulsion by which we were able to, we moved into co-living. But the results have been pretty good. In the last 3 years of the occupancy, we have been having almost 90, 92, 94% occupancy consistently. It is only during this pandemic that the occupancy has come down. Even there, it is, even today, it is almost at 30%. We still have the occupancies there in co-living. So co-living, easily designed properly for co-living, and if the location is good, we are easily able to match not the full returns as that of a commercial, but reasonably good returns. So at least a double-digit return. So anywhere between 10% plus return is possible. The rental yield on the co-living is possible, and that has been our experience. School also, we have tried it out, but then there are challenges. So again, with which school do you tie up? The ability of the school operator to pay the rent, that is again a very, very big challenge. If the person is not able to generate enough revenue, if he's not able to have a good catchment, the model is not going to be successful, because the school operator is going to raise his hands and say, I'm not able to pay the renters. So yes, schools are challenging, but then it is still exciting. There are a lot of bigger chains which are there, they're all on a satellite model with Oak Ridge and so many other brands which are there, who have attained a valuation of $1 billion by running schools itself. And we have our own homegrown Narayanas and Chaitanyas. So they're also being there in the market looking for schools. So schools also, if they're able to get a right location and right price of the land, and the construction, like Arun says, being done at an affordable cost, making their place affordable for school operator, yes, it can give a consistent and a long-term return. So also hospitals are also emerging. Chennai, like Habib said, that it is in the city which is there, where people across the country and other parts of the world also look forward to. So we have enough of the corporate hospital chains which are there, which are looking at, again, asset-light model, and we'd like to take the building, land and building on rent. So, and the new, the latest, which you mentioned, was the data center. Good amount of data centers are looking at, you said something like 35 megawatt is the current capacity. We are talking today of even the smaller players coming with one building with about 40 megawatts and 50 megawatts, which are there. And Hiranandani and all probably are talking about more than a few hundred megawatts of data center. I would like to have to urge Housing Secretary to even look at this data center as in a different product. It is apples and oranges can't be put in the same basket. So they cannot be treated as IT building. So you definitely need to have a separate policy for data centers, and what is the requirement of the market for data center. And we need to tailor make a policy which will, at least with respect to the development regulation, which can meet the requirement of the data center, and the development can take place in a systematic way.
Understand, Ajit. I mean, very well, very well taken, all your views about the importance of diversifying the portfolio beyond the traditional sectors. We are coming to the conclusion of this segment. I'll have Habib and then Sridhar speak about the issues, which are impacting the growth of the residential sector. Post that, we will hear the response from Thiru Rajesh Lakoni, sir. Habib, over to you.
The challenges, basically, I think Sridhar really covered up on this stamp. We've been consistently talking for almost 2 years now. It's highest in the country. It has to be reduced. And the other one is the GST, 28% for most of the goods and 18% for some, that has to come down. But by and large, the bigger the challenge for us is only from the approval perspective. Time-bound approval is the need of the hour for a business community. The time is actually money. Everyday delay carries a lot of interest and opportunity losses. If you look at Telangana, they have the steep pass, which is, approval in 15 days. So, I'm sure the Housing Secretary here, has been very, very helpful. Earlier, he was the Member Secretary. And, because of him, this CBD came, the common building rules. And thanks to people like Sridhar, who did a great job to get these things done. But we have a lot of issues in the approval. The time factor is the most important thing. A lot of delegation has to come, for the small districts. I think the approval has to go. Delegate to the local bodies with a clear, strict timelines has to be there. And there are a lot of issues in the layout, the local body needs to be streamlined. I think everything could be done in CMD, DDCP as a single window, rather than running up and down. So, and a lot many NOCs are becoming another issue. So these things, if we can be addressed, I think it would be great. I think we are in for a great time.
No, these are whatever Habib had pointed out is the points. The main is the local body. The local body which we have been going to for getting the building permit has been a nightmare, which the government is also aware. We have been constantly representing to the government. If somehow this amendment to the the Town and Country Planning Act is brought in such a way that everything is done in a single place, this will be a huge saving of time. From going to one municipality or one municipal corporation to one panchayat, all this is becoming a little bit of a nightmare. And in coming days, if this is cut, we'll be saving more than 6 to 7 months of the process. which will help in the cash flow and also to start the process of building. One more important point is the post-construction, you know, getting into the TNEP or the water connection. You know, even that, there is a delay. So our request to the government is make this also a part of the single window system, wherein everything is taken care, A to Z. Now RERA has come in. RERA says, no, RERA only, you know, goes on the builder. It keeps consumer interest as a main. But when it happens to be there is a delay in the part of the government to give the connection of either EB or on the metro water, RERA does not have the power to ask him. The amendment should come to RERA, where RERA, if it has got a real interest of taking the consumer interest as its main, it has to also take the government departments into its fold. It needs to tell the department saying that this is a month, 1 month if you're not given, why are you not given the connection? There are, you know, these things will help. You know, these are all the bottlenecks which are only slightly delaying the process. As otherwise, we have been very comfortable working with the government. And even in this, we are pushing, we are talking to them. They are also open to it, but there are a lot of amendments needed. That is why I think it's taking time. I think Mr. Akani is there. He will throw more light. Thank you.
Yeah, I think the two issues which they have pointed out and they've been continuously talking to us about is was the time cost of approval, because the delay is much more than it really increases the cost. And second thing is that how do you improve the liquidity, especially in the present context of so that people can rotate their money faster. And now the time cost is considered, I think it's not a one immediate day process, but we have done a lot of improvement from what we were, in the sense that we brought common rules, and the rules also have been simplified. Earlier rules were very complicated, and the interpretation by the builder and the interpretation by the regulators were very different kind of interpretation. Now it has been simplified and clarified. The second issue, what we have done is most of the NOCs we have done away with. In the sense, a lot of NOCs were requested earlier at the time of approval and at the time of completion certificate. I think those things also we have done away. The third thing is that we started with computerization. I think that will have to be improved further, in the sense we'll have to bring all the parastatals under the its fold so that in one place you can do. I think for rest of Tamil Nadu also, we started a computerization process. So I think we are moving in the right direction, and over a period of maybe coming to 3 to 6 months, we'll make significant progress. And I think there are issues on delayed approvals of things will be taken care significantly. Now, the second issue due to this pandemic, I think, which Sridhar mentioned earlier, was how do you improve the liquidity of the builder so that they can deliver faster and they can improve their costing? We are really working on various innovative ways of improving the liquidity, like security deposit can be replaced with some kind of mortgage of the flats so that it doesn't really have to part with the cash for giving security deposits. And how do we basically bring in... how do you structure the charges so that it doesn't really cost a really burden on the developers? We are already working with them, and we have been interacting with them almost on regular and weekly basis. I think there are a lot of things which are on cards I can't reveal because still it has not been approved. But a lot of things have been processed and in the process of approval. So I think a lot of good news for builders in coming days.
Wonderful, sir. Wonderful. I think everyone here are very, very delighted to hear this, because as we've heard from every stalwart here, cost of real estate financing is the highest at land stage. So any delay in approval gets, you know, loaded onto the cost, and we want to ensure that the home buyer does not, you know, take the brunt of this, right? So that is the view. Arun, are you wanting to say anything?
No, I haven't.
Okay. Got it. So I think that's the last part. And just to conclude, a quick rapid fire for all the five panelists. So just a one or a two word answer. So Arun, starting from you, if you are advising a home buyer, what is the most important factor that the home buyer needs to take into consideration while buying a home? What will your one word advice be?
The builder's consistent track record of delivering projects on time.
Got it. Noted. Ajit, does REIT make a good investment opportunity for people looking at commercial?
Of course, REITs makes excellent opportunity both for the developers as well as the investors. The ROI is excellent, getting about 7% with capital appreciation I think the two REITs which have come have proved that. And so also for the investor, he has a very good exit ready market under which he can offload his rental assets.
Got it, Ajit. Sridhar, one post-COVID trend which is here to stay?
Change of design. You know, people are looking at having a balcony. They used to close the balcony even if you gave a balcony. I think now people want a balcony. I think that's going to stay.
Got it. Secretary, sir, one important policy which will help in the recovery of the sector. You've outlined several.
Liquidity improvement for builders.
Liquidity improvement. I mean, we couldn't agree with you more. Habib, finally from you, you know, just to funnel the theme of this session, one characteristic that will distinguish Tamil Nadu from an investor point of view.
Law and order is the best here, you know. I mean, so much of peace and harmony in this part of the world. And we are a knowledge society, so I think that takes Tamil Nadu to a bigger way.
Wonderful. Many thanks, gentlemen. We had a fascinating...
Can I just make one more comment and then we can... I think we all made about the supply side recommendations in the sense that what builders... I think government is working on demand side, and if you see all the people exiting from all other countries, I think in last you would have seen that this government, I think that will be a major demand booster for the real estate sector in Tamil Nadu.
Absolutely. Fully agree with you, sir. I mean, during the times of lockdown, when the Tamil Nadu government went full steam, you know, signing those MOUs, sending those positive messages, when other cities, other states were just, you know, trying to get their house in order, was phenomenal. And we really know that all these investment MOUs will get translated into jobs, which will definitely benefit the ecosystem here. So it was a great, fascinating 60 minutes. Many thanks to each and everyone who made time to join with us, you know, for this session to promote our home state, Tamil Nadu, as an investment destination. As we go on, we will take some audience questions also and address them. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. So we had a very good session with the enlightening exchange of ideas from each of the panelists. And we've got very, very good questions also, which has come up from all the delegates who have joined this afternoon, because, you know, real estate is one of the most interesting segments, which has seen a lot of activity. So just to start this Q&A session, one common question which has been asked several times is that, you know, now we are talking about a scheme where we call it work from anywhere. As you can see, even the families are in different locations. So even as work from anywhere is picking up steam, how do you think, you know, the residential demand will increase in tier two, tier three cities? Because you no longer have to be in a primary city, because, you know, you have this option of working in your home, you know, which is being promoted by the employees. So, Sridhar, I'll start with you and then I will move to Habib on that. So how do you think work from anywhere will drive demand for residential in smaller towns and cities?
Thanks, Jerry. As stated before, you know, this has been one of the discussions right from the time the lockdown started. There has been across the board demand. Now people feel that, you know, they're going to work from home wherever they are stationed, at a smaller town or a big town or in the city or Chennai city or suburb. People prefer to buy home there. I think this is going to have a big drive on smaller places. People who are working from there will definitely look at buying. It is a very, very, very positive sign. It will drive in tier two and tier three cities in a big way.
Habib, your views on this?
Yeah, definitely. Yes. I think the pandemic has really taught, you know, the a big lesson to everyone that owning a home is a must, you know. The new generation, the millennials were thinking that, you know, I mean, not to buy, but this really taught everybody to own a home. Working from home, yes, I think it is really, you know, I know the guys, especially in the IT industry, who are working in different parts, you know, in major cities. Now, they all gone back to their hometown and they've been working there. As long as there is a good internet connection and a good bandwidth, I think that things will be there. At least for IT industry, work from home is then be there.
Got it, David. Yeah, definitely. I think going forward, work from anywhere will drive demand in the smaller cities. Arun, what we have seen as a property consultant is if you look at all the IT companies, most of them say that going forward, even when a vaccine comes, 20% of workforce will be working from home. You know, it could be on a fixed basis or on a rotational basis. So if you just look at stats for Chennai, Chennai has 65 million square feet. If you take, you know, about 100 square feet per employee, that's about 650,000 IT employees, the bare minimum. So if you take 20-25% of it, we're going to have about 150,000 employees who will be working from home. How do you think that will drive residential demand, Arun? Because we certainly feel that is a very, you know, good positive for the residential segment.
Putting things in perspective, even if 15-20% are going to work from home, Jerry, that is not going to be a reason as to why somebody would propel to buy homes. You know, work from home is could become a reality. I do agree that though a lot of people are waiting to come back to offices as a culture, I'm realizing that people are not very excited or very happy working from home, except for maybe a nursing mother or a you know, somebody who has a constraint, a lady who has a constraint to be at home. Otherwise, I see the whole population wanting to get back to an office space. In fact, you know, I would consider a lot of employees today would be happy to take even a small cut to come back to office than to work from home. So work from home, I mean, that's one part of the thing. But working from home is not going to propel a reason to buy. Now, I believe actually if hopefully the vaccine comes around and people start working from offices and life feels normal, business is just going to get back to normalcy. Then it's pure play how the economy is reviving from the bit of a dent it has had in terms of this whole, you know, corona and the lockdowns, which have hurt and bruised the economy in a big way. So has it to the industry too. So I think I'm not going to put a weightage to the fact that working from home is going to propel home buying. Home buying is extremely, you know, well understood today, as I mentioned earlier, regarding the fact that, you know, when people stayed during lockdowns, they understood the value of home. They saw the stock market taking a beating. They understood the real estate is a very decent asset class to have. So all those things is going to propel. But working from home is not going to propel.
Got it, Arun. I think that's a valid point. Sridhar, one more question which has come is, you know, how do you think stamp duty reduction will drive residential demand? So that's one question which has come from one of the delegates. So if you want to share your views on that.
See, there's any concession given to the customer, you know, this is one thing which has been a persistent demand from our side. It is, if you make a concession, you know, you give an incentive to the customer, you can bring him from the overall on the cat on the wall situation will jump to buy. This has been the result, what happened in Maharashtra, Karnataka and Andhra, Telangana. This has been a very big drive. You know, when there is a reduction in stamp duty, a customer who's on the waiting, you know, he'll be thinking what to invest, how to invest, how's his budget. Once he knows that it's from 7 or 11%, it's going to come down to 6 or 7%, even if it's for a short time, he will definitely, it will be a very big incentive for him to come and jump to make a decision to buy a home. You know, this has been a solid example in Maharashtra, which has given a very big boost to the sale. Lot of investors, lot of customers have come forward and started registering. So this will be a very big boost to the customer. They will come in to buy.
Got it, Sridhar. So definitely, I think, you know, if it goes in that direction, there would be additional impetus which will be there. Habib, the next question which has come to you, is that, you know, there could be a lot of landowners who are listening in to this Q&A also. What would your preferred acquisition model be? Whether it's an outright or a joint development, what could be the pros and cons for each, for both the models, especially when you're speaking about from a landowner's perspective?
Landowners definitely prefer an outright. I mean, definitely they need a good price. A good price doesn't come in an outright, you know, so it's a joint development. As long as they partner with a good developers with a good track record, they will definitely get a good, you know, value for their money. So, I mean, there's no second thoughts about it. A outright buying, anybody wants to pay outright to, you know, pay the full money, they will definitely look at a very, you know, they will bargain for a good price. So if the landowners want a good value, they will have to join hands with the developer and so that it is all achieved.
Got it, Abid. So, you know, definitely both options are available. So in cases a landowner is looking at a long-term realization, you know, if it could be a commercial project, if he's looking at rental coming in, then joint development would certainly be a preferred asset class. Arun, the next question is to you. You've had a very successful, probably 6-8 months, even during the lockdown with respect to your sales. How do you think you have digitized your sales cycle, Arun, right? From lead generation to closure. Is there anything different which you've done in the last 6 months?
We have just been very aggressive in the market. We have not really brought the prices down. In fact, people were contemplating, you know, price push down because of the lockdown, and that could help impetus. We have just been in the market, and we have gone about loudly, you know, making a lot of noise about the new products we had launched and about a lot of other new offers. But we didn't really give any discounts whatsoever, actually. And what we realized today, Jerry, if your pricing is being realistic and if your product is good and you have a good track record, like any of my co-developers here in the same forum, I think there are enough home buyers who are willing to happily come and buy. And they're really not getting too, you know, bogged down by this whole, you know, pandemic. Is what is evidently coming across by the results we've got. As I had mentioned earlier, getting about 1,200 crores of sales in the last 4 or 5 months is a huge number. Just that today, I'm realizing the strength of the digital media, like digital marketing, etc., yielding us a lot more results. In fact, even a TV as a new habit is yielding us more results as against the print. Print used to be the bigger media for us, whereas today the TV and the online media is giving us sizable results. So that's the only shift. Otherwise, the templates remain the same. I don't think we've really gone about any new routes of communication to home buyers regarding buying. I think, God willing, actually, we are all very scared when this whole pandemic started. But I think it's coming to slow death, you know, maybe in another year, year and a half. I mean, just a few more months, I'm sorry, not a year. I think it will have its death.
Understand.
Life will be normal. Then how the economy is performing, etc., is a million-dollar question. That's a separate thing. But this whole pandemic and the psyche and the whatever transferred because of that, I think is going to have its slowdown now.
Got it, Arun. I think that's a valid feedback. Habib and Sridhar, any technological you know, steps which you have taken from your respective firms during the last 6 months to drive the sales cycle, which you would like to share with our delegates?
I think digital is the way forward. I mean, I think rightly said by Arun. That's really working very well. Because today you can actually reach the right buyer, you know. Today the social media is working very good and very cost effective as well. And we can rightly target the right audience wherever we want. So today you want to target customers in, say, Dubai, so you don't have to go to Dubai to put a paper ad. I mean, you can sit in Chennai and then connect them the right you know, profile of people to get your sales. So a lot of things been happening, and you know, I mean, this is, I mean, during lockdown, the challenges to get the customers to the site. So we've been working on many areas. You know, everything's going digital these days. So I think those areas we're doing very well so far. The times have really changed. The pandemic has changed the entire way of doing business, and we are
Sridhar, you want to add anything?
Yeah. I'm with Habib and Arun on this. You know, digital has really caught up. This pandemic has taught us a lesson that, you know, there were instances where people were scared of touching a paper. They were saying they will not read a paper. All this came up, but now it's all back to normal. But digital has really picked up. You know, we have been very, very comfortable in the digital front. We have increased our budget on the digital side. And once again, like what Arun said, who can afford the TV also, TV segment also is doing very well. It is bringing a lot of leads. I think the digital side, more or less, most of the developers are into it now. I think digital is one thing which is there to live now.
Got it. Arun, the next question is which I'd like to post to you is compared to 2010 to 2020, has the buyer profile changed? You know, have you seen the age coming up? You know, you interact with a lot of customers. Do you want to just share some light on the buyer profile in 2020 compared to 2010?
In fact, I would think the buyer profile, the age band has dropped down a few years. So what's happened is at that point in time now, the whole talk about ticket sizes being important, etc., came in. Because prior to that, we all were, you know, predominantly doing slightly bigger sizes. From then on, we became very ticket conscious or size conscious. So we started doing a more tighter or a compact 2 bedrooms and 3 bedrooms also as some more options in the project offering. So what's happened is that's brought the affordability down a little bit, because of which we saw a sizable amount of the younger population getting ready to buy homes. You know, if you were to buy something at about 40, he was buying it at 35, 36. If you were to buy something at 37, he was looking at buying it about 33, 34. So that's what is happening. So we saw a lot of the younger profiles coming in. That is what is, I would think, is a sizable shift. And also what we are seeing very clearly is the number of double income families has gone up. If you had to do a clear stats, actually from the buyer profiling we had done in 2010. Okay, we did it in 2013. Let me qualify that. We saw a clear jump of more or less double the families which are having double income today. You know, even then we were used to talk about double income families, but actually for some reasons, as a fact, today when you see those numbers, this is what is looking bigger. And the third shift which has happened, not exactly the profiling, we always used to think that a third bedroom was very important and that everybody had the aspirations of a third bedroom. But today, a lot of people are thinking it is not needed to block the money for the third bedroom when they don't have a need for it at the moment. So a huge amounts of two-bedroom absorptions have happened. I'm sure that my other co-friends also, colleagues will also confirm that the two bedrooms have, you know, we are doing a lot of two bedrooms of small, compact sizes and larger sizes, and they are selling very well. We always used to think everybody is aspiring for only a 3-bedroom or a 4-bedroom, etc. I mean, probably 3-bedroom, 4-bedrooms are not so much, but which doesn't seem to be the case. Even if I have an affordability, I may still choose to buy a 2-bedroom if I don't have the need for the third bed. So that, because of which that is also changed. These are the few changes which I'm observing. But by and large, otherwise nothing much has happened. Obviously, larger communities are being preferred today, you know, as against smaller communities. People used to think larger communities hassle. People understand today that larger communities give a lot of facilities, etc. See, these are the few changes which I'm seeing by and large.
Got it, Arun. Got it. Habib, the next question which has come is a very generic question. So, you know, I'll just probably open it up saying, you know, will property prices go up? You know, that's something which most of the listeners want to hear from experts. So, you know, if you can share some light on that.
Yeah, I think the last 4-5 years, for whatever reasons, you know, we had one after another, a lot of reasons been happening, and the property prices were low. I think we see it is moving up now. You know, I mean, it's a cyclic business, you know. I think we have bottomed out and it is moving up now. Certainly there is, I mean, we are now aggressive in looking at a lot of lands last few months. And we see, you know, a lot of demand is coming. So, which means the prices are actually moving up. So,
got it, David. That's good to know from an investor perspective. Sridhar, the next question which has come up is for you. Apart from Chennai, what are the other cities and towns which are seeing interest, you know, from a real estate perspective? If you want to share some, like, the major towns and cities beyond Chennai, which is seeing interest currently?
Apart from Chennai and Chennai suburbs, you have a lot of interest developed in Coimbatore. Coimbatore has got a lot of interest. And which is now spread over from Coimbatore, it has spread into places like Salem and Erode, where a lot of interest has come. There is a lot of investors who are interested in buying places there. The next town, you'll say, as usual, the Madurai and Trichy has also been showing a lot of positive results. I think it is spreading now. The interest levels are spreading. Coimbatore is a major market driver after Chennai, which has got you know, large number of developers. And I think it is now spreading across Tamil Nadu. Even places like Tirunelveli, when we went there, I was shocked to see, you know, number of builders there. We have more than 70 to 80 of them doing there, and most of them were very successful. They were saying they were very happy doing there. So I think these are all a very, very welcome sign for Tamil Nadu. I think across the board, there is development. But if you see as investment being attracted, I will rate Coimbatore, Trichy, Madurai as one of the places which has got a lot of interest.
Coimbatore, Trichy, Madurai are the cities of promise, is what the Kadai Tamil Nadu chairman says. Habib, your view, you've been also looking at greater Chennai, you know, cities beyond Chennai. What is your view?
No, no. We've been doing properties across, but some of the apartments were not doing great in smaller towns like Tirunelveli. But the land prices are going. You know, the plots are still doing good. But last few years, because of a lot of changes, you know, the unapproval segment is completely finished. So now I could see, you know, a lot of people jumping in and a lot of traction being happening. Everybody wants into getting into more organized business, you know, in, from the, starting from the plots to residential apartments to, you know, to retail spaces. Everything is getting more organized, and I see a great future for real estate, and it is moving up.
Got it, Habib. Good to know. Arun, I mean, currently, if you look at it, we know that real estate is the biggest investment asset class globally. And could be the same in India as well. And many of your home buyers would be white-collared IT workforce. So you have on one segment, the wealth managers who advise, the IT workforce, saying move away from residential investment, put your money in stock market. And, you know, there's always a common question, you know, why buy when you can rent? How do you address that, Arun?
I would think that's, you know, they have been trying this for too many years, you know, that stock market mutual fund is far more better investments, and they projected all kind of calculations. Let me tell you a few very simple things which will downright beat the stock market hollow when it comes to real estate. First and foremost, the opportunity to leverage. Leverage means taking home loan up to 80% or 70% exists only in residential. For example, if I were to make a stock market investment, and if I have 10 lakhs in my hand, and if I go ask for a bank for another 40 more lakhs to make a 50 lakh investment, will the bank give me? So they won't give me. So the opportunity of leverage exists only in the home buying. And so hence, on the 40 lakhs of loan, which comes at a cheaper cost of 7%, if over the next 3-4 years, I have an opportunity to make about a 10% yield through the three returns which our housing gives, which includes the rental, which includes the tax breaks which I get on my principal and my interest, and on top of that, some appreciation which could happen over a period of 4-5 years. Even if it crosses 7% and becomes only 9%, just 2% spread or a 3%, 2-3% spread on top of the housing loan cost. You know, on my then 20% investment, my primary 20%, my equity investment, I would make a 14-15% return very clearly, point number one. Second is a home buying, no, gives a very committed reason to repay it back. Whereas a systematic investment fund or a SIP is something I can disengage on my whim. Whereas if I bought a home, there's a more emotional connect. Hence, I normally am very stringent. So obviously, it puts a pressure to, you know, pay month on month clearly the EMIs, etc. But that's a great discipline of a good saving, which otherwise would not happen. And on top of that, during this whole pandemic, we realized this is not just an asset class, right? Ultimately, it's an emotional connect. It's a roof on top of you. It's a home, ultimately, which is got stuck. When the whole issue happened, the government wanted us to get, to stay at home. So that's what you're talking about buying here. So if you're buying your second and third home, maybe then you can see it as asset class. If you're buying your first home, where is the question? You need a home as simple as that. You know, you are going to get stuck in the same place. So you'll have to do that. So, the whole stock market and the market can keep talking. But you know how much of money you'll anyway keep chasing real estate. I'm not saying it from any kind of, superiority. I'm saying it's a fact. It's a reality and it'll continue to stay.
Agree, Arun. So I think you've laid down all the facts clearly, quantitative facts on how your capital employed can have appreciation, the benefits of leverage, and most importantly, the emotional connect, which I think was clearly laid out this year, 2020. and we don't have the Black Fridays and Black Mondays like how you have in the stock market. So you can
just adding one more. No, the biggest worry or the biggest issues, you know what, Ajari? If the stock market were to collapse, no, it's visible in front of me. Or if it were to take a hit, it's visible. People are not able to handle that kind of a vagary or that kind of a dent. If a 10 lakh investment of your salary has come down to 4, you're very upset. Your family is upset. Everybody is visibly upset. A home, no, let's say a 50 lakh home, actually really doesn't really move or flicker in price so much, point number one. Even if it's not moved up very high, maybe the price have remained flat for 3-4 years. I do fully agree to what the Habib was saying. The market has remained flat. But it's not flickering as a price that comes down to 30-40 lakhs today, then goes up to 60-70 lakhs. People can't handle that vagary also, you know, when it comes to their investments. So even to that extent, psychologically, it helps to keep money in, you know, the real estate.
Very true.
You want to add anything, Mahabir?
No, I think perfect. No, it's been a revelation. I mean, he's a market leader and I think he said everything very right for everyone to listen.
Got it. No, I think that is a very valid thing. Sridhar, you spoke about it briefly in the panel discussion. Would you want to just spell out more on the design changes which you have done, probably what you'll do in the coming years post 2019? Because one question has been, what are the challenges post COVID? So if you want to address it from a design perspective.
Yeah. See, the design changes will definitely happen. You know, people like what Arun or Habib were saying, have realized the importance of home, which we ourselves didn't know before. You know, now is the time we have spent more time in the house. Even in my life, you know, last 45 years, I would not have spent so much of time in my home. You know, this is something which has taught everyone what is a house, how home is important. And now coming to design changes, you will all know that, you know, when somebody got affected by COVID, they were all asked to quarantine in a room. You know, it's like going into a room for 10 days or 15 days, not coming out will make you mad. So this is the system which has now said how, and balcony is very important. There were times, you know, when we used to give balcony after we hand over, they tend to close the balcony. You know, this was the habit predominantly, but now we find a lot of changes. People will have large windows is what they will expect, and they would like to have the good balcony. So these type of changes are going to happen. And it will come to stay in this coming market.
Jerry, you're on mute, Jerry. I think you're on mute.
Jerry can't hear you.
Sorry, I think I was on mute. So one question which has come now, probably the last question, is that, you know, GST on TDR is to be borne by promoters only, and it affects the promoters' working capital. Is there any solution for this? So I'll open it to all three. All three being, you know, developers, you will have views on this. GST on TDR is to be borne by promoters and it affects the working capital. How do we find a solution?
I'll let Arun and Sridhar answer this.
Yeah.
Sridhar, go ahead, Sridhar.
Yeah. GST, see, TDR, transfer of development rights, is what you go and buy. You know, naturally it becomes, gets added to the cost. It gets added to the cost. So it is an issue which we, you know, we cannot pass it on to a customer. If you want to pass it on to the customer, it is only in your rate that you can pass on. It is a strain. Definitely it is a strain, but that is a rule which we cannot break. And how we do the pricing is our smartness. You know, it is the developer's smartness in pricing it is what I feel. Arun?
Yeah, I mean, I kind of tend to agree. I mean, this is... something we might have. These are not the situations where we can debate or, you know, find solutions to this. Actually, we'll have to live with this. I don't think this could make a big change in the contour. A TDR anyways is coming at a cheaper price. I mean, a TDR is used only if the TDR rate is reasonably workable. So if there's a GST sitting on top of it, you take the TDR which is workable, that's all, and get on with business. I don't see any other, you know, anything else which anybody else could do.
Got it. I think that's good, simple and clear feedback. So with this, we conclude the session. We had a very, very interesting panel discussion right from the beginning when we had policy level discussion by Thiru Rajesh Lakoni. We had talk about commercial from Ajit. Arun spoke beautifully on the residential and on the investment side, also on industrial and warehousing. Sridhar spoke about various aspects which are happening beyond Chennai. So definitely there is opportunity beyond Chennai for investors. And Habib is a big supporter on promoting Tamil Nadu holistically, not just Chennai. And it was great views which came from Habib as well. So we want to thank all the delegates, all the listeners who have joined on in the portal on Facebook as well as YouTube. We are very sure that this interesting segment on real estate was beneficial for each and every one of you. In case if there's any further questions, please do direct to us and we will get back to you individually. Thank you so much once again to all the panelists, Arun, Sridhar and Habib for joining this afternoon. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Jerry, and thanks to everybody. Thanks to my colleagues here and thanks to the whole forum.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Habib. Arun, thank you.